It's time for another meeting of
The Science Alliance!
Hi, I'm Rex, and welcome to this meeting of the Science Alliance.
And I'm Judy. From the five clues we gave you at the beginning of the program, you've probably figured out that we're going to be talking about heat.
And our first question comes from our announcer, Bryant.
Thanks, Rex. Actually, our first question is from Susan, who asks, what is heat?
Well, actually, heat is energy.
Did you say energy?
Yes, I did, Bryant. Now, everything that is made
of... Thank you. That's my first word. And that means it's time for Bryant's Giants of Science. Almost 200 years ago, a British-American inventor named Benjamin Thompson did many experiments with heat, which led him to design the double boiler, the pressure cooker, and the coffee percolator. Thompson was better known by another name, Count Rumford, a title he received while working in a factory that made cannons for the Bavarian army. Cannon barrels were made by taking solid brass cylinders and drilling out their centers. Count Rumford noticed that a lot of heat was produced as the drills did their job. He concluded that this heat was generated by the drill bit and the cannon barrel rubbing together. After many experiments, he developed the theory that heat is a form of energy. Bryant salutes the scientist who first found out that heat is a form of energy, Benjamin Thompson, also known as Count Rumford, and certainly a great giant of science.
Thanks, Bryant. As I was saying, heat is energy. It works something like this. Everything that is matter is made up of small, moving particles called molecules. Molecules are so small, they can't be seen. As they move, they generate heat. The faster they move, the more heat is generated. You can generate heat energy for yourself by rubbing your hands briskly together. What you're doing is moving the molecules of the palms more and more quickly, and they generate heat energy. So remember, heat energy is generated by a movement of molecules.
Our second question comes from Laura, who wants to know, where can we get heat?
Well, we already showed you one way we can get heat, by rubbing. The rubbing of two materials together causes the molecules of the materials to move very fast and generate heat energy. This is heat caused by friction. Here's another example. John is sawing a piece of wood. The saw and the wood are rubbing together. How does the saw feel, John?
Hot.
Right. You can also feel heat caused by friction when you go down a slide, and the bottom of you rubs along the slide.
As Judy told you, if you rub two materials together long enough, you can create a source of heat by friction. Andrew, how does that feel?
Hot.
Hot. You can create another source of heat by friction, which results in flame, by using a match. The molecules of the wood are moving so fast that they change into something else. And as they change, heat is generated. This heat is caused by chemical energy. A candle flame produces heat in this way, and so does a car which burns gasoline. There are other chemical reactions which can generate heat. If you mix vinegar with baking soda, they make a mess. But Susan, feel the bottom.
It feels warm.
It's warm. There's heat, even though this particular chemical reaction doesn't cause a flame. You might be interested to know that your body is a heat generator too. The food you eat is the fuel that turns into heat energy and keeps your body at 37 degrees Celsius.
A chemical reaction like the one that takes place inside this battery creates electrical energy. Electrical energy is another source of heat. As the electricity moves through this wire, the electrical energy from the battery causes the molecules of the wire to move so fast they generate heat, cause the wire to glow and melt. We use electrical energy to create heat in toasters and electric heaters. Electrical energy also generates heat in places we don't need it, like inside a television set or a light bulb.
There's another source of heat that's so powerful that if it were not controlled, it could destroy all life on Earth. It's a nuclear reaction. Some of our electricity comes from large nuclear generating stations, where the heat from a nuclear reactor is used to heat water and turn turbines which generate electricity. The sun's heat is caused by a nuclear reaction on the sun. So we've told you about four sources of heat: heat from friction, heat from a chemical reaction, heat from electrical energy, and heat from nuclear energy.
Our third question is from Julie. What does heat do to matter?
At another meeting of the Science Alliance, we showed you the effects of heat on matter. We showed you two of the things that heat can do. It can change matter from a solid to a liquid, and it can change matter from a liquid to a gas.
We're going to try an experiment to find out what heat can do to a liquid, like the water in these flasks. I've given one each to Craig, Erica, and Tanya, and we've marked the levels of water in each of the tubes. Each person will warm the water by holding the flasks in his or her hands. Okay, you want to hold them? This may take a while, so let's go to Rex, who will show us what heat can do to a solid or a gas.
Julianne's going to help me with this one. This ball and ring are made of solid aluminum. Now, Julianne, please do me a favor and put the ring over the ball. That's it. Now, it goes over quite easily, doesn't it?
Yes.
I'm just going to do something here. I'm going to heat the aluminum ball. All right, Julianne. Put the ring over the ball. What's happened?
It got big.
The ball is bigger than it was before because it has expanded. So we've seen what heat can do to a solid. It makes it expand. Thanks, Julianne. Let's take a look at what heat will do to a gas, like the air in the flask. What state of matter is the air, and what's happening to it? That's right. Air is a gas, and the heat has made the gas expand. If you have trouble removing the lid from a jar, you can run the top under hot water. This makes the metal lid and the air inside the jar expand, and the top easier to remove. So we've seen that heat makes solids and gases expand.
Let's find out what happened to our liquid. Erica, what happened?
The water went up.
Did you find that? Did you? Heat made the water expand. So now we've shown you what heat can do to a solid, like aluminum, a gas, like air, and a liquid, like water. There are a few exceptions, but most matter acts the same way when heat is added to it. Heat can make matter expand.
Here's a good question from Joel. He wants to know, how can we measure how hot something is?
Excuse me, Rex, but what do you call how hot something is?
Why, it's temperature.
Thank you. That's my second word, and that means it's time for Ryan's Giants of Science. Early scientists worked long and hard to find a way to measure temperature. They knew that a gas like air would expand when heated, and this fact was used as the basis for the earliest instruments, like one invented by an Italian scientist. When a person held his hand on the round glass bulb at the top, the air in the bulb expanded and the water was pushed down the tube. These early instruments for measuring temperature were called air thermometers because they depended on the expansion and contraction of air. It wasn't until much later that someone decided that since a liquid also contracted and expanded, it could be used and sealed inside a glass tube, and a liquid-in-glass thermometer was invented. This was much more accurate than an air thermometer, besides being more portable. The thermometer we use today measures temperature in degrees. 100 degrees Celsius is the temperature at which water boils. 0 degrees Celsius is the temperature at which water freezes. And your body temperature is 37 degrees Celsius. Bryant salutes the thermometer, which measures temperature, and truly a great giant of science.
Yeah, 37 degrees Celsius. There are other ways to tell temperature, but the most common way is with a thermometer.
Here's a letter from Frankie, who asks, how does heat move from one place to another?
There are three ways to answer this question. Here's a demonstration of one way that heat can travel, called conduction. If I knock over this domino, what will happen? It will fall and bump into this one, and bump into this one, and so on, and so on, and so on. Heat travels between molecules by conduction. And the same thing happens when I heat one end of this rod. The molecules at this end start to move very fast and cause the molecules next to them to move very quickly, and so on and so on and so on. The heat from the quickly moving molecules will melt the wax and the balls will fall. And the wax closest to the source melts first. Heat travels from molecule to molecule by conduction.
Now I'll show you another way heat can travel, through a gas or a liquid, called convection. We're going to watch this through a thermovision camera that lets you see how hot something is. This is the flame of a candle. Just above the flame, you can see the heat moving by convection. Heat moving by convection can also do work. Large convection currents are called winds. They are caused when the sun heats the ground and the ground heats the air. In fact, without the sun's heat, there would be no weather.
I said that there were three ways that heat can travel. Well, here's an example of the third way. It's called radiation. Both conduction and convection need matter to travel through. But with radiation, it's different. It is the way that heat can travel through a vacuum, which means that there is little or no matter. Now, in the inside of this light bulb is a vacuum, which means that all the air has been removed. Ivy, put your hand against that bulb, but don't touch it. Now, what do you feel?
Heat.
Heat. The heat is coming from the filament to your hand by way of radiation. Radiation travels in all directions from the source. Heat from the sun travels millions of kilometers to reach the Earth. And it travels through the near vacuum of space to get here. So there are three ways that heat can travel: by conduction, convection, or radiation.
Now here are some questions about heat. How does a microwave oven heat the food without heating the plate?
Why does the metal leg of the stool feel colder than the wooden seat when they're both at the same temperature?
Does a barbecue cook by convection, conduction, or radiation?
There are many ways to find out answers to our questions. And there are many more things you might like to find out about heat.
Before we see you at our next meeting of the Science Alliance, find out all you can by experimenting, reading books, and talking to people. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Let's begin.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Yeah.